Hello and welcome to the May edition of Our Faith, Our Diocese. I'm Dan Gallagher. In recognition and appreciation of Monsignor Joseph Kelly's many years of service to those in need in our community, the diocese is holding a special mass and gala reception on Sunday, May 22nd. Joining me now to discuss this reception in greater detail, it's a pleasure to welcome Mr. Jim Bebla, who serves us as the Diocesan Secretary for Development. I'd also like to welcome Mary Teresa Vautrinot, who is the Diocesan Secretary for Catholic Human Services and the Executive Director of Catholic Social Services. Mary Teresa, first question. The diocese obviously feels very strongly about honoring Monsignor Kelly in this special way, but why?
Monsignor Kelly has done a fabulous job providing leadership for Catholic Social Services. He has been a role model for all of us in terms of living the mission that I would like to share with you. The mission of Catholic Social Service is rooted in gospel. The mission of Catholic Social Services of the Diocese of Scranton is to serve individuals and families in poverty and hardship, as we are called by Christ to do so, and to respond compassionately to their needs. As a Catholic agency, we advocate for individual dignity and self-sufficiency, and actively give of ourselves to replace despair and hope. I can think of no one greater than Monsignor Kelly that was a wonderful role model of this mission.
Jim, looking at the special day, I know it's going to start at St. Peter's Cathedral with a special mass followed by the reception. Tell me a little bit about the day and what will transpire.
Well, as you mentioned, Dan, we're going to begin with a mass that Bishop Bambera will celebrate, and Monsignor Kelly will be a concelebrant at the mass, and Bishop will give the homily at that mass. And then following the mass at the cathedral at 5 o'clock on Sunday the 22nd, we're going to have a reception gala in the pastoral center across the street. Tickets for that reception are $100, and we expect to have probably between 300 and 400 people attend the event. So we're excited about this opportunity to support Catholic Social Services, but also to honor the commitment of Monsignor to Catholic Social Services as Executive Director for the past 10 years. You know that he retired in December. He still serves as the Executive Director of St. Francis Kitchen. But we're really here to acknowledge all of the work he did during his tenure at Catholic Social Services.
Mary Teresa, obviously Monsignor Kelly is leaving behind an incredible legacy of compassion and concern for those in need. Do you think most people would be surprised at the myriad of services that are provided by your agency?
I believe they would be. Catholic Social Services provides services in 11 different counties, and we serve approximately 300,000 individuals and families per year. Some of the programs include adoption and foster care, Big Brothers, Big Sisters, adult and family counseling, housing and residential services, immigration and refugee services, the Hispanic outreach program, our material assistance and relief. Some of the other programs that we offer are for veterans, housing and shelter for veterans. We are very respectful and grateful for their service. In addition to that, we offer drug and alcohol programs for those in need. Parenting education, pregnancy and maternal health care, St. Vincent de Paul Kitchen, senior services and youth services.
Wow. Jim, for someone who's watching this interview today and they would like to either possibly sponsor the event, maybe even take out an ad in the program, how can they go about doing that?
Well, we have a number of opportunities, from purchasing a ticket to come to the reception, to purchasing an ad for the program book, to making a donation, to being a sponsor, to sponsoring a table. And if they're interested, they can contact the Diocesan Development Office, or they can go online at the csgala.org. So there's many ways that people participate, and we have a nice planning committee together that made up of a number of representatives from some of the advisory boards of the Catholic Social Services regional offices and programs. So we've got a great group of people that are interested in helping out, and it's a wonderful thing. As I go talk with folks about supporting this and about coming out to honor Monsignor, you know, everybody has a Monsignor Kelly story. He has touched so many lives in his ministry at Catholic Social Services, and then a 50-year ministry that he's about to celebrate in May of his priesthood. So it's going to be a great event, and we encourage everybody to come out and to participate.
Mary Teresa, when you reflect on the work that Monsignor Kelly has done for this diocese over these many years, why does he serve as such an inspiration, not only to you, but to the staff at Catholic Social Services?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, Monsignor Kelly truly lives the mission. He also demonstrates for Catholic Social Services caring, serving, and solving, which has always been his mantra. And as you mentioned, Monsignor Kelly is officially retiring. However, as you said earlier, he is continuing to serve at St. Francis of Assisi Kitchen, but he also spent the first 6 weeks of my time here and the Diocese of Scranton with me, shepherding me in my journey in this role. As all of you know, I have big shoes to fill, and I would like to thank him for his personal attention and efforts in ensuring that I succeed and carry on his legacy.
Jim, even now, celebrating 50 years as a priest, and he's still working as director of the St. Francis of Assisi Kitchen, do you think his legacy of compassion and concern for others will live on in this diocese for many years to come?
Well, Dan, Pope Francis calls on us particularly to care for those most in need, and that has been his life's work. You know, as you mentioned, not just in Catholic Social Services, but his entire work in the diocese, the entire ministry. He had worked for many years teaching religious education to students, worked at Camp St. Andrew, been involved in several different parishes, so he's well known and well appreciated, and he is a true servant of the Lord without question. And he approaches, I think, one of the great things about Monsignor Kelly is he approaches folks on an individual basis, and he helps people one-on-one. I've seen him in action, and it's a great thing to witness his humility and his respect and dignity for people. I think that's what makes him as successful as he is, and that's what people appreciate.
Mary Teresa, the money that we do raise through this gala reception will be used to benefit the many services that are provided by Catholic Social Services. Can you think of a better way to honor a man who gave so much of his life in service to those in need?
I think Monsignor Kelly, in his humble way, would say it's been his honor to serve in his leadership role. And I personally will accept the torch that he has passed and do my very best to carry on his legacy.
On Saturday, April 23rd, nearly 1,000 men from around the diocese gathered here at King's College in Wilkes-Barre to take part in the second annual Catholic Men's Conference. As we'll see in this next segment, this day of inspirational talks, music, prayer, and fellowship was an opportunity for men in our diocese to rediscover their identity as men in Christ and to renew their commitment to serving God and His church.
You go back to 1492 when Columbus sailed the ocean blue. What were the most populous Catholic countries in the world back then? They were Spain, Portugal, Italy, and France. Fast forward 5 centuries and what are they today? In first place, Brazil, second place, Mexico, and in third place, our own United States. Countries that didn't even exist 5 centuries before are now the single most populous Catholic countries in the world, and the ones that once were are struggling to rediscover what little is left of this legacy of faith that used to define them. Implicitly, John Paul was asking us, where are you going to be in 5 centuries? Or in 3 or 4 for that matter. And he wasn't giving us some negative prognosis, some dire prediction. He was challenging us to lay hold of the gospel and rediscover the grace that makes us more than creatures, more than servants, more than employees. It makes us more than forgiven sinners. It makes us sons of God. It brings us into the family of God. It reveals the face of the Father of God. And now we have Pope Francis, who's like the new evangelization in high definition, or as a friend of mine says, the new evangelization on steroids. We are living in an age of giants. In 20, 30, 40 years, don't be surprised if your grandkids ask you, "Grandpa, what was it like to be alive back then when there were saints walking this earth, giants in the land?" And we'll say, "Well, we knew at the time, of course, you know," and well, we don't. But now we do. And we're called to join them. And we're looking at a world that is falling apart. We're looking at a culture that is in self-destruct mode. Why is it that this world is going crazy? For one thing, there's this rampant pathology that I would describe as paterphobia, a fear of fatherhood, a revulsion, something that is so deep people who have it don't even know they've got it because it controls all their thoughts, their feelings. When you look down the list of all of these things that seem to afflict our culture and cause us to self-destruct, what do they all have in common? Fornication, pornography, adultery, abortion, same-sex marriage, masturbation, contraception, divorce. They all attack the heart of fatherhood. They deny the fruit of fatherhood. They reject the fidelity of fatherhood. They attack the sacrifice which involves the gift of life and love. Fatherhood is more than physical. It's more than biological. It's more than siring offspring. God is the one who illuminates what it really means.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Merciful and mighty God in three persons, Blessed Trinity. God in three persons, Blessed Trinity.
Well, I would say praise be to God that we have between 850 and 1,000 men here. Last year we had about around 750, so we're really excited. Everyone's worked really hard, probably 140 men worked together to put this together. And so, you know, it's fantastic to see it all come together and men enjoy the camaraderie, enjoy the speakers, and I think it's a successful event. We heard Monsignor Pope sort of say that it's up to us. We can't look for someone else. We can't be spectators. We need to get in the game. So we need to try to be holy ourselves and then spread the gospel, starting in our families and into our parishes and out into the world.
Excellent, excellent conference. Last year was fantastic as well. This year, very, very applicable. Messages like Scott Hahn's message about fatherhood and what is biblical fatherhood and what is God, what kind of a father is God to us, and how he loves us and how we need to apply these things at home. I mean, it's very, very encouraging. Loving the conference.
Our world often esteems a kind of a cartoonish manhood, you know, where We think of manhood as those who are rich and powerful or socially powerful or physically strong, and those are good traits. Those are good, strong, masculine traits. And I'm rich, but I mean, you know, the strength, right? But my brothers, as you know, as a man of God, God is looking for something far deeper and far richer than mere externalities. The man of God is anchored, firmly anchored in the Lord. In the Lord. And so he knows what the Lord God expects of him. And he gets up every day and he says, "Lord, what will you have me do?" And he does it. He's rooted in the Word of God. So we want to be not just a man, we want to be a man of God. I am under God's authority. I'm a man who's sent. I have been given marching orders. I have something to do that the Lord God has given me to do, and no one else can do it. And I'm going to go, and I'm going to do it. That's a man of God, see. So as for you, oh man of God. So when we are told, my brothers, that step one in becoming the kind of man Jesus was, is that we should pursue, lay hold of righteousness, it's not like, okay, study lots of rules and try to keep them out of your own flesh part. My brothers, that isn't the gospel. The gospel is to meet Jesus Christ, let him bring you to his Father. And having met them and being overwhelmed by them, the Holy Spirit just pours out love in your heart, and you're inspired and you're excited, and you don't keep the commandments because you have to, because you want to, because you're excited and you're inspired. Are you praying with me? You and I, if we're going to be the men we're called to be, have got to cultivate a relationship with God. To be inspired by Jesus and let him lead us through the Holy Spirit right to the heart of the Father. You see, the danger is that God's kind of on our list, but he's not at the top. Some of us love our careers and our comfort more than God. Some of us love other people more than God. Some of us will obey other people before God. Too many people today, my brothers, including all of us, we struggle with this. It's a human problem. We tuck our faith under our politics, under our comfort, under our career. But when you really start to love God, that no longer becomes possible. And so beg God, increase your love in my heart. Increase it, Lord. I need it. Because it will unlock all these other things. It will unlock the magnificence of righteousness and godliness. When I love you, I'll have a holy reverence for you, born in love. I'll hold you in wonder and awe. When I love you and you told me to do something, I'll believe it with all my heart, and I'll do it even if it costs me something. I'll do it because, Lord, I love you. I love you. I really love you. So I give you that charge. I pray as God who's giving it through me. I do not say that none of you have done nothing. I'm sure you've all done many and wonderful things. But my brothers, it's very, very dark today. Apparently, not enough of us are shining the light of Christ. So fight the good fight. Jesus Christ is the model of our manhood. Jesus Christ, he is the one who showed us the way, who manfully went to the cross. He set his face like flint toward Jerusalem, and no one could turn him back. He never stopped speaking the truth to the day he died, even up on the cross, speaking the truth in love. And that must be our charge, to speak the truth in love. Jesus is the true face of manhood, and he needs a few good warriors like us.
Manhood is a big issue with me, and the presence of manhood in the church. True manhood, and the title was especially appealing to me. True manhood, and I loved what Monsignor Pope said about standing up as men and proclaiming the gospel with a prophetic voice. You know, the prophetic voice needs to be the declaration of the truth. You know, we've come to the point in our culture, and sometimes it appears to me in religious circles, where if a man speaks up like a man, not the spiritual version of Vito Corleone, we're not talking about that. When a man speaks up like a man, like Monsignor Pope said, you know, the balance between excess and defect, speak up like a man, we're speaking up like Jesus. Jesus didn't walk around winding his hands like this and apologizing for the truth. He spoke it. You know, we have to take our access to prophetic portions of our baptism.
I came to the conference today because I think that we, especially as young men, get a lot of confusing messages about what we're supposed to do, what we're supposed to be like, especially, you know, in the church, what we're supposed to represent. And, you know, it's that message society is giving us versus message that we feel and message church gives us. So I think that coming here today, I was sort of hoping to get an idea of, you know, like helping me understand what it means to be a man, what it means to be a Catholic man. It's fantastic so far. Dr. Scott Hahn was a wonderful speaker to start us out with, and Monsignor Pope as well got really fired up and got everyone going, which was nice. I think I'm really, again, I'm just looking for that message of, you know, I'm maybe more practical things I can do, you know, ways for me to start becoming more of a Catholic man, embracing Catholic manhood, you know, just taking away those messages from each of them. Maybe it's saying certain prayers each day. Maybe it's the message of going to confession more often, you know, whatever it may be to help me embrace Catholic manhood more. That's what I'm really looking for.
Ever heard Romans 8:28? God orchestrates all things for those who love him. Just like that song I sang, Jesus and Mary, you are near. Are they? Can I get an amen on that? Are they near? Amen. You better believe it, they are. You better believe Jesus Christ is in the center of our home. You better believe he was carrying every single burden of my heart and my wife's heart. You better believe he was with us. I needed to believe it, though. And then I needed to respond. I have three young ones that are in front of me, that adore me. They needed something from me still, regardless of if it was raining outside, regardless of what was in the pantry. They needed something that I could still give them. My heart. They were still looking, just like that last song. Father, give me your heart. They're longing for my heart.
In faith I tremble, my fears convict me. I thought by now my prayers would have saved me. These voices, they are my choir of angels. They throw me down to where I do not want to be. Some days I just let it all live out as my hope empties into doubt. So Father, will you please let me know it's gonna be okay.
Here's another truth. It doesn't take much to get up on a stage and talk to a bunch of people. It's not really that big of a deal. Let me tell you what's more pleasing to God. Not that we serve the masses, that we serve the one. There are people that cross your path and my path every day. Some of them are family, some of them are friends, some of them are strangers. And guess what? They need something from you. If you are willing to give it to them, you're going to find the true path, the narrow path of life.
I want it to be heroic and inspiring. Wanted to offer you the greatest sacrifice. Like all the saints gone before me, I tried to prove my love for you, and so to gain the prize. I wanted to be a martyr like Cecilia, to cut off my long hair like lovely clay, to be faithful like Mother Teresa in the darkness. Lord, won't you make me just like her? I tried it.
an incredible gathering this is today. Gathering as we continue to celebrate and give thanks for the Easter gift of God, Jesus raised from the dead. And gathering as a group of faithful men from around our 11 counties. It's never about numbers. It doesn't need to be. What it's all about is what's in our hearts and the depth and authenticity of our commitment to the Lord. But it doesn't hurt for you to hear that at our peak moments today, I'm told that we had close to 1,000 participants. Give yourselves a round of applause. I would suggest that we stand at a crossroads, don't we? We can build, protect, and lead a world whose principal ends are rooted in material things, in passing pleasures, in valueless endeavors, in the satisfaction of our own ego needs. Or we can build, protect, and lead a world whose ultimate purpose is to seek the lasting things of God, the well-being of the lives that God has given to us, and those values that have the power to sustain us through life's journey, come what may. We have a choice in what kind of world we're going to build and where we're going to invest our time. The American television journalist Tom Brokaw, of all people, once said this: "It's easy to make a buck. It's a lot tougher to make a difference." The challenges facing us as Christian men today could not be greater. Yet we simply cannot gather here today and smugly point a finger at the world around us as the focus of our concern and our disdain. It would be easy to do that. The real battle that we're called to wage is less with our world and its skewed value systems, and far more with ourselves and how we understand what it means for us to be authentic disciples, authentic followers of Jesus Christ. Jesus comes to each of us today. Give him room in your lives. Become the men that God has created every one of us to be. Love generously and selflessly, and work with God to build his kingdom in the corner of God's world that he has given to each of us. God bless you.
As part of the diocese observance of World Day of Prayer for Vocations, Bishop Bambara celebrated a special mass on May 1st at St. Matthew's Parish in East Stroudsburg. As you'll see in this next segment, this liturgy was an opportunity to pray for all vocations, but in particular for those men and women who are being called by God to serve the church as priests, men and women religious, and as deacons.
You take off your cross, the sign of my Brothers and sisters, welcome to St. Matthew's Parish. Welcome to this celebration of the sixth Sunday of Easter and the Church of Scranton's celebration of the World Day of Prayer for Vocations. What a blessed opportunity this is for all of us to see from where I stand, and this is a pretty good seat in the house. This church filled with members of this faith community, our friends up the street at East Stroudsburg University. We have representatives from all over Monroe County and well into the remainder of the Diocese of Scranton, from parishes, from colleges, from youth groups, from schools, all joining together to praise God, to affirm our desire to live as disciples of Jesus, and to walk in the ways that the Lord entrusts to each of us.
May God have pity on us and bless us. May He let His face shine upon us. So may be your way known upon earth, among all nations, your salvation.
What are you going to do to build the body of Christ? And that's a question not particularly focused on those who are young, on religious or priests. It's a question that's asked of every one of us in this church. We say we're Christians. We stand up readily in a few moments to affirm our faith and profess all that we believe about the God whom we adore. But what does that mean for us? What are we going to do to live the mission of Jesus? How are you going to respond to the gift of the Spirit of God within you? What will you do with Jesus' gift of peace that calls us to mission and that demands of us, if we seek its consolation, to serve our brothers and sisters? Will you keep the gifts that God has given to you tucked away behind the locked doors of our lives because of fear or how we wonder that we might be judged, or because of what the world might suggest if we act in a certain way? Are you going to lock up what God has given you? Or are you going to step out in faith and risk trusting in God? The most important thing any one of us can ever do, to risk believing that somehow, no matter where we are in life, God will hold on to us. My friends, Jesus is calling all of us to be His disciples and to build His church. Every one of us right now is being called by Jesus for that mission. And for some of you, right now, Jesus is revealing His plan to you to serve His church as a priest, a deacon, a religious sister or brother. My brothers and sisters, open the locked doors of your hearts. Don't run away from God and try to be somebody that you aren't. Walk out of this church tonight and remember the words of Jesus spoken to us in tonight's gospel. Do not let your hearts be troubled or afraid. Say yes to Jesus and become the person that God has created you to be. God bless you.
On Monday, July 11th, golfers from around the Diocese of Scranton will be gathering at the Blue Ridge Trail Golf Club in Mountaintop to take part in the 7th annual Vocations Golf Classic. Joining me today to discuss this tournament in greater detail, it's a pleasure to welcome Father Don Williams, who serves our diocese as both Director of Vocations and Director of Seminarians. I'd also like to welcome Mary Louise Ruan, who is the Director of Stewardship for the diocese. I welcome both of you. Father, my first question, going back a few years ago, why did the diocese decide to set up a special endowment fund for our seminarians, and how does this golf tournament benefit that fund?
Sure. Well, as you know, and I'm sure many families know, the cost of education is becoming exorbitant, and we certainly would never want that to be a reason that would hold someone back from embracing the call to diocesan priesthood. So I think the Golf Classic, the endowment, is helping us to do two things. First, to provide some direct support to the seminarians as they prepare themselves for service to the diocese. And so that is the first and most important part of this endowment. And second, it is allowing us to have monies available to enhance a vocation culture in the Diocese of Scranton. There's a need for education, for information, but also engaging young people in retreats, discernment groups, activities, our vocation camp, so that we can have an opportunity to really plant some seeds and invite the possibility that if God is calling someone to the priesthood, there's nothing holding them back. You know, that they'll just dive in, stay open, stay available, and let God speak to their heart.
Mary Louise, as you reflect back on the last few years, year after year, this tournament is a huge success. What do you think that says about the type of support that you're getting from faithful across the diocese?
Well, I have to say that people are so happy and anxious to support our seminarians. It's wonderful. It's just always amazing to me. And we always have new donors. The beautiful thing about this golf tournament is that we're not just looking for golfers. You know, we are looking for donors and sponsors. And we acknowledge the smallest donation, and we welcome the smallest donation. So all donors are recognized, you know, in the Catholic light and on the program, whatever your gift. We take memorial donations, if you wanted to have a whole sign in honor of a loved one. Even on the program, your smallest donation can be made in memory of a loved one. So I think in that way, we give people the opportunity to embrace it, and they do so. They really love the idea of helping seminarians and encouraging and fostering vocations.
Father, traditionally, we have a number of our seminarians who come down every year to be part of this golf tournament. Why do you think that's such an important element of this event?
I think it's a critical piece to have the seminarians present because it connects, you know, the people of God with those who are in formation. And I've just finished visiting all our seminarians in the three different seminaries. And to be honest, they're very excited about this. They're excited to come. They have the date in their calendar. And this will be my fourth year with them. But I think it gives them an opportunity to help. Also, you know, they're direct recipients, but it also gives them a chance to give back, to be available, to be of service. It gives them a chance to say thank you to all the people who are helping us. And it also gives an opportunity for them to say, we have really good guys in formation. And they're all in different stages and phases of their academic career.
Fortunately, I was on board when we founded this back in 2010. This is our seventh year. And it's always been a great privilege for me to have the seminarians there. They're wonderful help. You know, they're setting up, and there's the registration, and the, you know, and we have some of them speak during the meal. We just have one seminarian give a very short a comment, but it's been great to see them interact. You know, that they really enjoy helping, and they always thank me that they can, thank you for being part of it and letting them help. it has been wonderful. But I also want to add that, over the years, over the past 6 years, we've raised over $500,000 over $500,000for the seminarians and their education and the vocational outreach. So it's just all, it's a wonderful experience. And so many people who attend, I see them interacting with the seminarians and talking with them, and they it's just such an enriching day.
And for some of the guys, this could be their fifth Vocation Classic. And so they're back for their fourth or fifth time, but also so are the golfers or,
yes,
you know, the staff.
All
and
yes.
So that interaction, Pope Francis in his message for World Day of Prayer for Vocations for 2016 is saying that vocations are born from the church, from within the people of God. And he's hoping in this extraordinary Jubilee Year of Mercy that all the baptized will really come to appreciate our vocation by virtue of our baptism, and then live our life in an intentional way. But for the church to be the church, then we have to keep fostering vocations. We have to keep witnessing, and we have to call forth, we have to sustain, support the vocations. And this kind of just throws everybody together in a very informal and wonderful way.
It's a wonderful event. And I say that because it's run so smoothly. We go to Blue Ridge Golf Course, which was just recently named number one public course in Pennsylvania by Golf Advisor. So that's quite a distinction, you know, the number one public course. The grounds are beautiful. They have 27 holes. Golfers will know this means that we only take a maximum of 176 golfers. That's the maximum we will take. So there's no waiting, there's no tie-ups. It runs very smoothly. It starts at 11, we have lunch. We have a shotgun start at noon. And then we usually finish up 4:30 maybe. And we have a very nice reception and dinner. The program is very brief, you know, because golfers know, you know, after a long day of playing, they really don't want to have any kind of a formal program. It's very brief. We have awards, we have prizes. And we usually conclude 6:37, 7 o'clock. It's a very nice day. We make everything as pleasant as possible. You know, there's nothing obligatory. It's just lovely. But I do want to say that if you golf, you know, you will enjoy it.
We have representatives from all parts of the diocese. And so they come and they say, okay, well, here's what we do, or this is what happens here. And bottom line is keep things moving. Start on time. And so, the staff at Blue Ridge really works with us, and they've been there forever. But also when it comes time for finishing up, you know, you want some social time and the interaction, but then you want to eat and move on. You don't want to be there for the whole night. And, you know, from what people have shared with me, this is probably one of the most efficiently run golf tournaments. And that's good. I mean, to have people leaving saying this was a really nice day. I think the personal touch of the seminarians and our bishop, you know, to be there, I think is key. And also, one last thing I'll add is it's pretty cool also when we have young people golfing. So we have some of our Catholic schools that have their golf teams there, or some fathers will bring their sons, or some daughters are coming. But it's kind of fun to have young people. So it's kind of an event that crosses ages and stages and parts of our diocese, and I think it's a very successful effort.
For someone who would like to be part of this event, be it a golfer or maybe they just want to make a donation, what's the best way of getting in contact with you?
Well, they're welcome to call us. It's the development office. This is a really coordinated effort between development, you know, the development office. We do the annual appeal. We raise funds, and vocations. So, but we're doing the logistics. So if they call the development office, it's 207-2250. That's 570. Or they can go on the website, dioceseofscranton.org, and they will see the tab for vocations. And the brochure will be there.
Father, you mentioned this earlier. We have an incredible turnout, a representation of all our parishes, laity, clergy, deacons. But traditionally, if he can make it, Bishop Bambera goes out of his way not only to come down to the tournament, but to play in it as well. Why do you think it means so much to everyone there to see their bishop as part of this golf classic?
First of all, he knows everybody that's there pretty much, or they know him. He also is able to say thank you You know, and so it's not just you're going to get a letter thanking you, but to personally say thank you. I think the fact that he golfs with the people is it's a great witness. It's a powerful sign. He's having fun with everybody else, and he'll bust on himself about different shots or how the day is going. But I think it's also a tremendous gift to the seminarians to see him, you know, casually here, moving among the people of God, enjoying the day, spending time with them. And so I think it speaks volumes about, you know, his priority, his availability, his willingness to support this effort, and his desire to say thank you.
Mary Louise, you mentioned earlier the incredible amount of money that this golf classic has raised for our seminary program. When you think about that and you look around at the people that are coming down to support this golf classic, does it make you realize how committed the faithful of this diocese are to helping young men answer the call to the priesthood?
I say this all the time, you know, because I raise funds for the church. This is what I do, and part of the appeal, and this tournament. And people say to me, well, you have such a hard job always raising money. I say, no, you know, we are so blessed. There are so many faithful people who want to support the church throughout the diocese, throughout our 11 counties, that they're very happy. And sometimes it's sacrificial giving. You know, it's people that maybe don't have any surplus funds, but they will still share. So I'm thrilled. I'm thrilled to in any way be aligned and associated with this effort. And it's very gratifying for me to be able to be among these people who want to support our priests.
We come to you now from Holy Family in Luzerne, where the parish and its sacramental minister, Father Joseph Elston, recently started offering a monthly interpreted mass for members of the deaf and hard of hearing community. In our upcoming conversation with Father Elston, we'll see how this particular faith community is doing all it can to promote the full and active participation of Catholic deaf and hard of hearing individuals in the church and the mission of Jesus Christ. Father, this would be a commitment for any parish to take on the responsibility of offering a monthly mass for the deaf and the hard of hearing. But why were you and the rest of Holy Family so excited about doing this?
Well, first of all, this is where I am now. This is my parish community as the sacramental minister here. It made sense to invite them here. We were previously having masses at St. Joseph's Oblate Seminary, and it was a mass just with us, just with the deaf community and myself. And an interpreter. And so it made sense, I thought, to include them in the parish community where I am now and to try to have the Mass here instead of a separate Mass just for them.
Speaking of that, you made a point of including this particular Mass with a regularly scheduled Mass, the 11 a.m. on Sundays. Why was that important to you?
Well, because I think it's important for them also to feel part of a parish community. Previously, the Mass was interpreted at St. Mary's in Wilkes-Barre, and they used to be able to go there every single weekend. That has stopped now, so there is nowhere for them to go on a weekly basis where there would be an interpreted Mass that I'm aware of, at least, in the diocese. There could be somewhere that I'm unaware of, but here, once a month, we're regaining that schedule that we had of once a month for the deaf community to come here for an interpreted Mass.
Father, as you look out at members of the deaf and hard of hearing community when they attend this Mass, why do you think it means so much to them to feel fully engaged in this liturgy?
Oh, they very much want to fully engage, and they very much want to have Mass. They're very faithful people, and so when it's offered on a regular basis, they will respond in time. It sometimes takes a little time for them to trust the system that it's going to work and it's going to be there for them, but I think in time, more and more we'll see that this is what we're going to do now.
Ostensibly, we're offering this interpreted Mass for members of the deaf and hard of hearing community, but for the rest of the people sitting in these pews at that 11 o'clock Mass, do you think the entire parish community benefits from this liturgy?
Very often now, in the beginning, they're watching the interpreter a little more often because they're kind of interested in that and fascinated, but it's a very welcoming community, and many of them have commented to me that they're delighted to have them, and many of them have introduced themselves after Mass to the deaf community that have been here to welcome them personally.
Father, on a diocesan level, what kind of services are available through our Office for Parish Life for the deaf and hard of hearing?
Well, any time that someone from the deaf or hard of hearing community would need something, would need perhaps an interpreter for, say, a family funeral or whatever, the diocese has a number of people that they can call upon to provide that service to them. If they would need counseling or certainly sacraments, confession, or a deaf person in the hospital, I'd be more than willing to go and visit them and take care of that. I have enough sign language skill to get through something like that pretty well. And that would be something we would be able to offer. They would be able to use that as a resource to find someone who could offer interpreting services for them when needed.
And is help available for members of the deaf and hard of hearing community who may need sacramental preparation?
Sure, if that were a situation. We haven't had too much of that so far. The community is getting a little older. We're trying to attract some younger people and put the word out there. That's what we really would like to do, is to kind of enlarge this a little bit now, put the word out there that this is a regular place where an interpreted Mass will be offered, and who knows how that could grow. It might grow to maybe more than once a month if the numbers were such. Sometimes some of the people who have come already have come again, even though they knew there wouldn't be an interpreter here that particular day. Actually, she was here that day.
While the majority of these interpreted Masses are being offered here at Holy Family, I noticed they had the opportunity to take part in the Palm Sunday liturgy at St. Peter's Cathedral. They'll be invited back to the cathedral this December. Why is it so essential for them to feel that they're also part of the Mother Church of Scranton?
Oh, you said it yourself, because that is the Mother Church of the diocese. And they are used to having a larger celebration followed by a social or a dinner at Palm Sunday and just before Christmas, where we would get 30, 40, sometimes 50 people at that. Doesn't sound like a lot, but for them it's a lot. And they're used to that gathering and also that social time afterward. So I'm sure they're thrilled to go to the cathedral and have the bishop celebrate the Mass and gather together in the pastoral center afterward.
Homage for him.
Father, as you reflect back on your many years as a priest, why does this particular ministry hold a special place in your heart?
It was kind of by strange accident that Monsignor Delaney and I, before we were even ordained, were asked by the diocese to consider going to Gaudet University in Washington for a summer to begin to learn sign language. While we were both seminarians in East Aurora, New York at Christ the King Seminary, we both worked in our apostolic work at St. Joseph's School for the Deaf. And we also took a few classes there after Gallaudet, just to kind of continue to brush up and work. And we taught CCD to the youngest kids at St. Joe's, and that was a great experience too. So it kind of got us into it then, and both of us have done our share of work within the deaf community through the years, as has Father Jeff Walsh too.
Father, through baptism, each of us come into this world with special gifts and abilities. When you reflect on members of the deaf and hard of hearing community, what kind of special gifts can they bring to a faith community?
They understand their faith very well, and they practice it very well, and they are delighted when they, all a priest has to do is sign one thing, and they think you know every sign in the world, and of course you don't, but they are so excited when they see that the church reaches out to them. Whether it be a priest or an interpreter who is coming to Mass and helping them out, they are very excited when they see that and very happy that someone has taken an interest in them. And they respond beautifully.
I know you're hoping that the numbers will start to increase for this monthly Mass. What kind of a word of welcome would you like to put out there for members of the deaf and hard of hearing community?
I would like to invite them to check on the diocesan website to see the dates of the Masses, and know that they are most welcome. There's no requirement for membership as far as joining this particular parish. As long as they want to be here for our celebration with the interpreted Masses, they're more than welcome to come.
And why do you think this is such an incredible experience for them, to realize that they're not alone, that there are other deaf and hard of hearing Catholics out there in the diocese?
Well, they know each other. Most of them know each other from social organizations, from the Catholic Deaf Association that has kind of, in this present day and age, kind of faltered a little bit because the members are older now. This group was around when I was in the seminary, and that was a long time ago. So a lot of those members have died, and many of them are older now. So we really are encouraging all age groups to come and be part of this, and the more it grows, the better it'll be.
Come,
That's all the time we have for now. On behalf of the staff at Catholic Television, I'd like to thank you for joining us today and invite you to tune us in again next month for our next edition of Our Faith, Our Diocese.
The time will race. When the rains come, no, I'm your friend. Do you understand?